Okay, so last time we talked about the intertropical convergence zone and the subtropical high pressure system. So air rises at the equator, it's a low pressure system, and goes up into the upper atmosphere and then descends at about 30 degrees. That's the subtropical high pressure system. The winds that come off of there are the trade winds and the westerlies, and they go from a high to a low. And also notice there's a low up here. It says subpolar low. And these are our winds that are bringing in storms to the north of us right now. And then they turn to the right because of the Coriolis force. And these winds are what bring in hurricanes here still in October. And I wanted to show you how the winds start out, let's say in Africa or in Baja, south of Baja, and move across and maybe hit the Hawaiian Islands or the Philippines for sure. And we've had some huge hurricanes and typhoons created by the trades. Let's come on in, you guys. Morning. Okay, so let's say off the coast of Africa we have very dry winds, and I'm going to use this sponge to represent the wind blowing across the Atlantic Ocean. And so as it goes across, there's not a lot of friction. It's going across the Pacific Ocean. Here it is, zooming across, and it's starting to pick up moisture as it goes across here, and gets more and more energy, and then basically it might start hitting some islands and things like that. And I have a volcano here today. So this is in the Philippines where we have volcanoes. And as it's cruising across here, it goes over a few mountains, maybe it rains a little bit on them, and then hits perhaps a large mountain. And all of a sudden, that's where we get lots of rain. See that? Okay, so that's why Florida, for example, is very wet, whereas let's say East, that would be West Africa, would be, particularly in the northern part by the Saharan Desert, would be very dry. And as it goes across here, the opposite at the same latitude is very wet because the trades pick up lots of moisture off the ocean. Okay. And what really helps is that when the mountains, it hits a mountain or some kind of land, it tends to force the air up even more, and we get some torrential rains. In Hawaii, which also has volcanoes, right? It's created by volcanoes. Some of the wettest places on Earth are at the very top of these volcanoes. Okay. So the trades, back over to here, are very consistent. There's not a lot of friction. They bring in our hurricanes and our tropical storms. And they tend to be in the tropical regions. Okay, so moving on up to the westerlies, let's talk about that. We're at 38 degrees in latitude, and those are our winds that bring in the storms, and that usually starts after Halloween. For some reason, there's this magic day. It's not exact, but it seems like right now it's supposed to get to 90 degrees, and then the day after Halloween, I remember this a few years ago, I was riding my mountain bike around and I was having a great time. It seemed like summer was never going to end, and the next week it was quite cold out. So all of a sudden the subtropical high pressure system that protects us and keeps us warm, it finally dissipates, and we start to get in those that cold air and those storms from the north. Okay, so let me see what I have on my notes here. So they're not as consistent as the trades because they are going across continents like North America, and it tends to slow those winds down. Another thing about the westerlies is they tend to meander. So right now, if you look, the winds are really coming from the north, and they're actually going around us and have been pushing the marine layer out to the ocean. And that's kept us really hot and dry. I don't know if you noticed, it's been very dry. Not just hot, but dry. And even on the coast right now, they're not getting the marine influence because the winds are coming from the Sierra Nevadas and from the north, northeast, and they're really holding off the marine layer. That's going to change later in this week, and we'll start to get back to our normal pattern. So the jet stream does meander, and we call that a Rossby wave. So write this down. There's a couple things about the Rossby wave. First of all, it does create an undulation in the jet stream. What is an undulation? That's like a snaking up and down movement. You know when it's really obvious here when the westerlies change pattern is when we have a really nice February. Here in California, we get lots of nice weather in February. And then all of a sudden it snows in the foothills the next week. You know, so sometimes the winds are coming from the south, southwest, and then it switches from the northwest. And all of a sudden it changes on dramatically. That's the Rossby wave, okay? And over here, which is not in the screen, but in our notes, write down, you know, undulation. It also, the second thing, what it does is it can bring in some pretty severe weather. Let me grab something here. Okay, so. Okay, so here's a map of the United States. And this could be even in the wintertime, let's say in January, and then as you get into spring, it could force the jet stream up way to the north of us, and then this very cold, dense air comes down here during the springtime, let's say in March, April. Then you can also get some warm tropical air. And those of you who did tornadoes for your presentations, what it was is really a collision of these air masses. The meander and the jet stream collides. There's no mountains as you go through the Great Plains. Past the Rockies, no obstructions. So that cold air can come zipping on down, collides with the warm, moist air, starts to create a lot of unstable weather, and you can even get a tornado out of that. Okay? So the Rossby wave's in part responsible for that very cold air coming down from the north. And it can go all the way down into Texas and in Oklahoma, where we have Tornado Alley, right? Okay, so that's the Rossby wave. The next thing is the polar highs. So let me put this back. So to review for pressure, we have air that's rising or sinking, and it can be thermally induced. So for example, right here at the intertropical convergence zone, the sun is directly overhead, and that heat makes the air rise. That's thermally induced. So now going up to the polar highs, it's really the lack of heat. These air molecules are getting closer and closer together, and they sink. So I brought something here to show you that. Okay, so let's say this is the Earth, and this is Antarctica right here. And Antarctica gets really cold. Okay, there's many reasons why it gets so cold. There's actually a cold ocean current that goes around it, and there's a curtain that essentially keeps any of the warm air from mixing with the cold air. And as it's in total darkness, right, and that would be in our summertime, right? It'd be in total darkness, their winter. I've represented it right here with this cold air mass. And see the arrows that I have right there? Okay, so the cold air is going to start moving its way toward the heat, right? It's going to, it's not gravity, it kind of looks like it's gravity here, but it does move toward the warmer areas. And now there's going to be yet another collision that I'm going to talk about in a second here. So the polar highs, let me look at my notes here to make sure I'm on task. Yeah, just a couple things here. So one, it is cold sinking air. Cold sinking air, and it creates a dramatic, so sinking air is either high or low. What is it? High or a low? It's a high pressure. Now, I think of high as sunny weather, right? In this case here, it can be sunny in Antarctica if the winds aren't blowing, it's not crazy. So generally speaking, actually, that sinking air will create clear conditions. Okay? And where do we get a dominant high pressure system? Well, over, let's say, you know, areas, let's say in large continents. There's really two that come to mind. One is Canada and North America in general, and that's around Hudson's Bay. And then also we have the Siberia, you know, in Siberia, where we have this Siberian High and the Canadian High, right? So those are the two points there. Okay, so here's another diagram, okay, of the different belts. It's more of a profile. Here would be the Canadian High, It hangs out up over here, and still cold air as you head up toward the North Pole. And this is the part I really want us to focus in on right here. So as I showed you guys just a second ago, air is moving toward the warm air, and it collides with what's existing before it. One thing about cold air and warm air is they don't mix very well. Now, about a week and a half ago, we had a storm that came through here. It helped put out our giant fire. And it stayed cold for quite a while, didn't it? Mm-hmm. And that's because the cold air and the warm air don't mix very well. Okay? And you can see that right in here. They're kind of showing this giant bulldozer. I kind of call it a bulldozer. And this can go up, you know, many thousands of feet. And as the bulldozer comes in, it forces air in front of it. Okay, you see that? And that is going to be a low pressure system. Now, it is not thermally induced. The boulder, the bulldozer is actually pushing the air up, and so it's dynamically induced. Excellent. And that's, you know, motion. So dynamic means motion. And those are our two flavors here, thermally induced, dynamically induced. So make sure you write that down. And it's probably a good idea to draw that. I've given you guys this. So as you get up into about 60 degrees in latitude, this actually affects us. This will be affecting us the day after Halloween. Because what happens is storms start to form as the air is rising. Storms will force, it will start to form and then head our way. That's huge. So that is the subpolar lows. Okay, it's a giant front that's typically formed out there. And I looked at the weather satellite and I actually saw quite a bit of that. So I wanted to, in just a second, take a look at the weather from the satellite. Let's talk about the polar easterlies and then we'll take a quick break. Let's go back to this. Before I do move forward, while this is up, here's kind of a zoomed in version of it. Okay, so here's the polar front coming in at 60 degrees, between 50 and 60 degrees. This is the Arctic Circle is 66 and a half. So this is in Alaska off the Aleutian Islands. And it creates a dominant low pressure, which we call the Aleutian Low. And you can see it's forcing air up here. And also the polar jet stream is up there. Okay, and then the next one, our final, belt / wind is the polar easterlies. The trades are a wind that we have. We have the westerlies. And then we have the polar easterlies. They actually come from the east. So if you were in Fairbanks, Alaska, northern Alaska, the winds will be coming out of the east, not the west. And they come whipping across there, especially along the coast there. And why do we have those winds? Well, take a look at it. We've got a high up here. We have a low, the subpolar low I just went over. The winds go from a high to a low. And then they turn to the right because of the Coriolis force. So while that does look like it's moving to the left, if you go upside down from the perspective of the arrow or the winds, you'll see it is turning to the right again. So everything we've said, just in summary, and then I wanted to take a look at the weather. Everything we've said in summary is that, hey, winds blow from a high to a low. They turn to the right here in the northern hemisphere because of the Coriolis force. And if the Earth were much smaller, we'd just have one of these systems. But because it's larger, we have several of these Hadley cells. Okay, and your book talks about that. Okay, so here we are taking a look at the current weather satellite here in October. And just to get our bearings, here's the United States. We do actually have some warm tropical air coming up from Baja right now. And if you look at the very bottom here, you can see a lot of storms cruising across, and they are moving from the east. These are the trades, right? As you move up north, the wind direction switches, and you can see a storm that is forming off the Aleutian Islands. This is really rough seas out there right now. Surely somebody is out there at sea, maybe fishing for salmon or whatever, and they are in the middle of getting rained on. Now those storms are going to go into the northern part of British Columbia today, and it looks like even Vancouver is going to get spared in the southern part of British Columbia. And we're definitely getting spared, right? It's a very hot day here. But this whole system will start to move south. You'll start to see this, these storms moving south as the sun moves south, and that system will start to come in and hit us. And I predict it'll be the day after Halloween. It's usually somewhere in that zone. Okay, so it's neat to see what we just talked about in the real world. Okay, that's called the Aleutian Low, because it's consistently generating storms like that. Okay, so now we're going to talk about this diagram right in here. And you can see this purplish color right here, right? Now this is just an average of what goes on in terms of barometric pressure. The purple is low pressure, okay, and the red slash orange is high pressure. This would be taken, let's say in January, kind of an average of January. This will change, by the way, for the summertime. All right, so let's say this is around the equinox, around Christmas time. I keep saying the equinox. I meant the winter solstice or Christmas time. And you can see that we have high pressure. It's actually not directly over the poles here. You can see it's more over the continent. And then you can see the low right in here. So what is this again? This is cold air moving toward the warm air, and it just simply forces it up. Now notice it's over the ocean here, okay? Because the oceans relative to the continents are warmer. It's not like you're going to want to go swimming in the ocean in the Aleutian Islands, but relatively speaking, it is warmer. And so that air will rise, and it will have a collision with this air mass. And the other thing I wanted to show is right here in Siberia. This is a Siberian high. And let me grab something here real quick. Okay, we have a silly aluminum can right here. You see that? Now, what we talked about earlier is specific heat. Specific heat is the property of something to heat up and cool down. In the case of an aluminum can, it will heat up quickly, right? And it will cool down quickly as well. So the continents are an analogy to the aluminum can. They'll heat up quickly. So this will actually change to a low pressure system in the summertime when the sun is as high as it's going to get. And you will see that turn to a low pressure system, by the way. And then in the wintertime, the continents are going to cool off quickly. They're going to reach probably their coolest around the winter solstice because the aluminum can cools off, right? The sun is way south. They don't have very long days, and the cold sort of begets cold, and guess what? Air is sinking, and so there in Siberia, it is very cold. Okay? So I just thought this was a great diagram to show this contrast. Look, same time of the year, and yet vastly different. One last thing over here is the Icelandic Glow. This brings in a lot of storms to Europe. That's kind of their source of storms.